Good morning, and welcome to all of you as we gather together in heart and mind and spirit. And happy Mother's Day. In 1905, a woman named Anna Jarvis proposed the idea of a Mother's Day, and she said, "I hope and pray that someone sometime will found a memorial Mother's Day commemorating her for the matchless service she renders to humanity in every field of life. She is entitled to it." Anna Jarvis was born in West Virginia, but then for much of her adult life, she lived in Philadelphia. Believe it or not, her efforts to recognize mothers didn't go well at first in Washington, D.C. The politicians somehow thought it wise to vote against mothers. I'm not sure if they voted against apple pie, too. But of course, eventually, the mothers won. And in 1914, President Woodrow Wilson declared the second Sunday in May as a national holiday honoring and memorializing mothers. Well, God bless mothers and all of you on this morning as we gather together with this gift of worship. Now, in joy and gratitude, let us worship God. Come, let us gather in heart, mind, and spirit to worship the source of all life, our God eternal. We gather as people of God, turning to our Redeemer and Savior. We turn in trust to our God of steadfast love and faithfulness. Bless us this day, O God. May our praise welcome you. May our voices of praise bring us closer together this day, wherever we may find ourselves, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Let us worship God. Now we will sing, "Come, O Fount of Every Blessing." Thank you. great chasm between heaven and earth that only God can bridge. Let us confess our fallen ways and our need for God. Because we are better at tearing down than building up, O God, forgive us. Because we don't make Christ our foundation in all things, forgive us, we pray. Strengthen our faith so that we may live Christ-filled lives. Amen. There is nothing in this world that can own you. No person, no place, no job, no circumstance, no past sin that you may have committed. Because of the gift of Jesus in our world, we are all forgiven and freed to be who God would have us be, in harmony with God's creation. Praise be to God.
Amen. Amen.
May bring us wisdom, strength, trust, and hope. Amen. Our first scripture reading this morning is from 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 1 through 10. Rid yourselves, therefore, of all malice, all guile, insincerity, envy, and all slander. Like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow into salvation, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. Come to him, a living stone, though rejected by mortals, yet chosen and precious in God's sight. And like living stones, let yourselves be built into a spiritual house, to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For it stands in Scripture, "See, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone, chosen and precious, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. To you then who will believe, he is precious, but for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the very head of the corner, and a stone that makes them stumble and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the word as they were destined to do. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, in order that you may proclaim the mighty acts of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy." Our next reading comes from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 10, verses 13 through 16. People were bringing little children to him in order that he might touch them, and the disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant and said to them, "Let the little children come to me. Do not stop them, for it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it." And he took them up in his arms, laid his hands on them, and blessed them. Sometimes people say, "Do you really need churches to find God? Can't we just find God in nature?" Or sometimes people say, "They aren't building that big church to glorify God. They're doing it to glorify themselves." Other times people say, "All that money that they spend on the church and church costs could be given to the poor." Every one of these statements carries some truth in some aspect and make important points to be considered. However, each one of them has certain drawbacks and flaws in that kind of thinking too. And I could give a variety of responses to each of those statements, but first, I would like to take a moment to talk about the stones of this church. They're visible up in the attic, and whenever I go up into the attic and see those stones, so many of them look like field stones, I think about our forebears who built this church in 1835 and how they brought those stones out of the ground without modern equipment, shaped them roughly and handed them up on some kind of a scaffold, handed them up to be placed in the walls of this church so that we might have this building that we worship in. Someone might ask, "Why gather all these stones from the ground and cut and shape them and pile them one onto another so that we can have a church building?" They might say, "Is it necessary to have this building to find God?" My first response is to say that stones themselves have no meaning in themselves. The stones don't offer us some kind of a moral vision or something good or bad about them at all. Stones are just stones. So therefore, it's what we do with the stones that give them the worth and the goodness based on our thoughts and our feelings and our behavior. There is no objective, clear-cut way to measure the worth of stones and what we do with the stones in themselves, one way or the other, of course. In the book of Acts, stones were even used for violence as they stoned one of the first Christians to stop his voice, a Christian named Stephen. And then in a very different way, we hear in the Gospel of John, Jesus speaking of rooms and abodes and mansions in heaven for us, and that he's making building preparations for us in heaven. And so stones really can be used for good, for bad, there's even a heavenly sort of stone, you might say. It's true that we read in the Gospels where Jesus would go out into the wilderness and pray to be close to God, but most of the time Jesus was gathering with people. He spoke in synagogues, he taught in the temple, he broke bread with people in their homes, always bringing to those structures a blessing as a meeting place of grace and love. Jesus didn't object to stones piled one upon another, shaped into buildings. He used those structures for God. In the Gospel of Luke, after Jesus ascended into heaven and all of the apostles found themselves alone, they went and they gathered in the temple together, praising God. They gathered in one place, it says, and not separately, not alone, and not just in nature. And of course, we all love nature. But often in our Bible, it is in gatherings, in all sorts of places and structures where God's work is being done. Stones are just stones. Sometimes they can be missiles of violence. Sometimes they can build walls of separation. Sometimes they can build buildings that glorify man, not God. But what sweet glory and goodness when those stones help gather folk to turn to noble pursuits, to seek and follow God's ways, and to know each other as people of God, truly together in a world that too often divides us apart. Gathering, it seems, is getting harder and harder in this world, and especially in this time. These stones that quietly serve us here at St. Peter's, visible in the attic, placed there in 1835, allow us to do what God desires of us. That is, to gather, again, right here, inside these stone walls. And we will gather again. We shall gather again. And what a glorious time that will be, just as they gathered in the Bible. In 1 Peter chapter 2 that we heard from this morning, it says, "Come to him, a living stone, though rejected by mortals, yet chosen and precious in God's sight. And like living stones, let yourselves be built into a spiritual house." To leave our daily lives behind and to come together as people of God, as we have done, as we will do, to gather in God's house, to remember who we are again, who we really are as children of God, that we belong to God. All of this is not just a blessing. It is also critical for our world that we gather and we remember and we share the gift of God's good news out into the world. It's no wonder that people love their churches, that they love not just the people, but their church building. They know instinctively that churches are more than just stones. They create a space where heaven's grace meets the struggles of the world. Our time will come again when, like the first apostles, we can gather together as followers of Christ, as living stones in the spiritual house. Victor Hugo, who wrote the book The Hunchback of Notre Dame, loved the stonework and design of the French Gothic Cathedral Notre Dame. Scholars now believe that he knew of the humpbacked stone carver working on the cathedral at the time that Victor Hugo was writing his novel. Interestingly, the main character of the book is hunchbacked. His name is Quasimodo. And that name comes from our first scripture reading today, when the Apostle Peter says, "Rid yourselves therefore of all malice and all guile and insincerity, envy, and all slander. Like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow into salvation." Like newborn infants, says Peter, sort of in the form of, you might say, and that's what Quasimodo means, that the heart and soul of the character Quasimodo, in spite of his outward appearance, are sort of in the form of a newborn infant, an innocent, with a purity like a newborn. Hugo would have us question what ugliness really looks like when comparing not the body, but the soul of Quasimodo and some of the people of the church and the town in the novel. People filled with guile and insincerity and envy and slander. And Quasimodo is the living stone that Peter's letter calls us to, that we are to be living stones, so that God may build from us a spiritual house. The stones here at St. Peter's still echo with the words and the songs of Sunday mornings all the way back to 1835. But this spiritual house longs for the regathering of living stones once again. We come fully understanding a world of guile and insincerity and envy and slander, and yet refusing to fall prey to cynicism. We dare lift up and proclaim the meaning of Quasimodo and Peter's call, where he says, like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow into salvation. Our modern world too quickly dismisses our faith sometimes, as if the words of our faith cannot be held up against some of the ways of this world, that the truths of our faith, the truths are too innocent to be applied to the realities of our world today. How sad that so many in our world today don't understand the value and the beauty and the depth and the truth of our faith. The great minds and souls of Christianity throughout the centuries have proven that our faith is not some false choice between some kind of innocent naivete and then versus the worldly views that we have out here with the cynical world that we live in today. There's a deeper faith for adults. It's a false choice. Our faith can stand up against all that the world offers and bring good news in a very real and meaningful and true way. One writer described a second innocence by saying, the second innocence means recovering those feelings of enthusiasm and faith and presence and curiosity associated with childhood, and then blending them with the knowledge and experience of adulthood. We are to hold fast to a sense of wonder in our world, and we are as Christians to stay focused on what really matters, what matters to God and what matters to heaven, and not just the world. The idea of faith, the idea of covenant with God, relies as much on wonder as it does on rational choice. For God is just as much mystery and poetry and even miracle as it is rules and commandments and dogma. This is how the stones come alive. Jesus says in our second scripture reading today from Mark, let the little children come to us. Do not stop them, for it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it. Within the stones of our church, we are to be living stones. Like newborn infants, we are to long for the pure spiritual milk so that by it we may grow into salvation. On this Mother's Day, we lift up all mothers, but we also lift up the heart of mothers. A mother's heart sees in the children the purity of their little hearts that hasn't yet learned to be more cynical like some of us older folks in the world. A mother's heart understands a purity of faith that has not yet been disillusioned, that hasn't yet needed to understand our faith more deeply in the face of sin and darkness. The trust and belief of a child is a precious thing, even a sacred thing, and that's why our heavenly parent cherishes such faith and belief in people of all ages. Just as a mother could never explain her deep love and knowledge of a child, so we can't simply explain God and God's love and knowledge of and for us. To be alive in the faith, to be a living stone, means more than just the acceptance of certain beliefs. Children understand intuitively the love of Jesus. If we adults replace that simple acceptance of Christ's love with a list of certain theologically correct beliefs, how sad for us. And just as much as we could learn what God wants of us when seeing the trust and innocence and love of a child, so we can learn more about God, about who God is, by knowing the steadfast love and care of mothers. As the old saying goes, God could not be everywhere, and therefore God made mothers. We are in the Easter season, when we celebrate a Savior who is with us always, even now and forever. For the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. But this is also Mother's Day, and on this special day that celebrates all mothers, we could do well to understand our faith more. We could do well to understand our God more by looking to mothers. Happy Mother's Day. Amen. Everywhere we pray, from the nuclear family to the extended family, families with step-parents or single parents, families with or without children, or for whom the children are grown, families whose beloved pets are their children. We pray for all the many expressions of family in the world. We also pray for families that do not have a home, who are struggling with poverty or war or natural disasters. Have mercy, we pray, and never let us stop caring about all families that are struggling, that your heart may be our heart, and that we may see as you see. And we especially pray in this time of the global pandemic, we pray for families all around the globe who are struggling, who aren't sure where their next meal will come from, who are concerned about sickness, who mourn the loss of a loved one. Have mercy and watch over us at this time of struggle in the world, we pray. In every home, we pray that they will look to you to make your home with them and fill their home with your blessings. On this Mother's Day, we honor our mothers, and we also give thanks and remember those mothers who have gone to their eternal home. We pray for our church family this morning and all those on our prayer list, and we pray for those on our hearts and minds, whether spoken out loud or in the silence of our hearts. All of this we pray in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. The church offers a sense of extended family and caring in a world that too often leaves people feeling alone, even forsaken. The church dares to strive for heavenly things in the midst of our world of struggle. Please now consider an offering to the church so that the stones of this church may continue to witness the joyous work of God for years to come. Now we will sing, Be Now My Vision.
Oh,
may find yourselves in this Easter season that offers us a resurrection promise, a covenant now and forever. May that carry you and be your truth and be your identity now and all through your lives. Amen.